How many are you from IRI? Devyani, yourself?
4, 5.
Aap to yahi ka.
No, no, I was just asking the students.
Hello, good morning everybody. We'll be actually, the whole idea of this National Agricultural Education Program is that you are young brains and we would like to mold you at this stage to understand what are the ways in life that you can move ahead, particularly if you have chosen agriculture per se, isn't it? So it's very important to understand that everything is not for every occasion, but you need to use this technique as per your need. If you don't use, then it becomes waste. You can start with anything and you can get some results. This is, I don't know what these awards are called as, alternate noble, stupid awards. So it's like dropping a pencil, and my pencil which I drop from top, it takes 1 minute to reach to the bottom and there are 3 deaths. You can make a beautiful correlation, right? So you should be very, very positive to know which technique you are using. Now, for example, we take this class, right? This class has gender female, gender male. So if I use the intervention as gender, this 40 students get divided into how many groups?
2 groups.
Very good. All of us are from different states. I am from Andhra Pradesh, she is from Tamil Nadu. Maybe you are from Arunachal Pradesh. So if we divide the same group based on the states that we come, then maybe we are divided into 7 or 8 or 9 states. 9 groups. Same pupil. Now if we just make a corollary, let us divide by age, maybe 4 groups. Maybe profession, maybe we are 3. One technical person, one scientific person, other students. 3 groups. The subjects are same, 40. Now if you just correlate with your plants, because this is humans, this is daily we are envisaging, therefore it is not appearing something surprising from you. Now if you have taken 100 genotypes, let's say someone is working on floriculture, and we take 100 genotypes and use morphological basis for clustering them, and you have used metroglyph technique. There are different techniques. Metroglyph aapne padha, D square aapne padha, abhi SSR markers aage. So if you take metroglyph technique, what does metroglyph do? It takes the most variable characters, puts them on X and Y axis, and then divides, rapidly divides this into 2 major groups, 2 major most variable character-wise grouping, and the rest all are depicted as the length of glyphs or the rays on the circle, isn't it? Right? Tevyani has done this, let us say in rows. Aapka naam kya hai? Bhanu, what she has done, she has taken same 100 genotypes what Tevyani has taken, or 200 genotypes what Tevyani has taken. And what she has done, Bhanu, she has used now what you call as D square analysis. The same 200 genotypes we just formed into 2 groups, then again you have used mean and 1 plus SD and she would have made 7 groups. They have now grouped differently, right? She would have contradicted in her thesis or would have cited. And aapka naam beta? Anamika, know what she has done? She started using modern techniques and she started using SSRs. And this has divided into 8 groups. Tevyani would have recommended crossing between A and B as per her groups would give the largest diversity. Bhanu has given between group 1 and 6. She would have given some other genotypes. Are their groupings wrong? They're not wrong, but basically 3 of them didn't know why they started grouping for. You should understand. First, this objective is most important. Same thing is in your life. What is the objective? You know, what is the objective of this grouping? If there were large number of genotypes, let's say 800, 900, 1000 rows cultivars, and she wanted to make quick homogeneous grouping, then metroglyph is good. You understand that? 100-200 mein metroglyph jarurat nahi hai. If there is a large number of genotypes with large amount of variability, maybe for flower chloral, maybe for flower structure, maybe for diameter of the this thing, then if she would have used, then she would have got simple, similar homogeneous groups, and then you would have used, because at every place the intervention that you are putting, instead of gender, instead of let's say state, we are putting an intervention. Everything has an intervention, what we call as a statistical intervention. For example, when you are doing metro d-square analysis, it uses a cutoff value called a Stockrese cutoff value. And if some of you are a good statistician, you can play with this. Wo generally 0.3 rehti hai. Yani wo kya karti hai? It takes for a most variable character a mean, aur uske saath jo 0.3 plus or minus 1 standard deviation hai, uske saath milati hai, baaki ko fekti hai. Phir then it takes remaining mein mean, us most variable character ko leti hai, usko mean karti hai. Within a group, it takes the second most variable character. Isliye when you are doing d-square, you get the contribution, percent contribution of characters to diversity. Everything is with a purpose, right? So you should know this. For example, if Anamika is interested in fingerprinting, then doing d-square or metroglyph is waste. She has to take AFLPs, not SSRs, right? You should understand for which technique, what is your purpose of breeding, or what is your purpose of using a particular technique. So you have different techniques. So most of the breeders would have, or the crop improvement persons would have told of various techniques. So we'll be speaking on tilling, right? Now, tilling means targeting induced local lesions in genomes. Now, what happens is, now again we move to a second corollary. Okay, I try to put it in corollaries that I take because she is my student. Okay, don't feel why I'm taking her name. Now, Tevyani, we don't know, has come from Mars, right? Now, we don't know, we all don't walk, and this Tevyani is able to basically walk. But I don't know what is helping her walk, because we all don't walk. We are all sponges who are sedentary. So what we do, we remove the hand of Tevyani, but still she is able to walk. We remove the second hand of Tevyani, still she is able to walk. Now I remove one leg, so she is limping, right? I remove both the legs, she is unable to walk. So I come to the conclusion that the legs, which are the appendages of Tevyani, are helping her move. So this is a physical removal, right? If you do at chromosome level, this is called as deletion, right? So why do we do? We need to understand whether a particular gene that is there, right, is actually giving the same function, and to what level and where it is situated. Maybe in your things you would have read, when you are looking at chromosomal anomalies, deletion mapping. Did you hear about deletion mapping? So you need to first create a deletion stock, right? That means you need to create deletions in your chromosome for different segments and understand that the absence of this particular chromosome, what function it would particularly lead to, right? But to develop a deletion stock, which is useful for deletion mapping, it would take almost 20 to 30 years. We had my teacher here, Dr. Sarkar, who has taken almost his whole life to create whole of the deletion stock in maize, almost 30 years. Now, neither we have the time, nor we have what you call as so much of resources, nor my career advancement helps me practically. So we hit upon a particular technique. We'll be coming as we move around. Before that, I think I should thank all jewels at a single go, right? Then another thing is that it is a reverse genetic, non-transgenic tool. It is efficient. But if you look down, it basically combines the EMS techniques with high throughput genotyping techniques. So why it is possible? I have given all this in your notes, but you can take the lecture freely. Okay. See, when you are actually looking at, there should be, you should ask me questions, you know. For example, aapko QTL mapping bhi bataye honge? Kisi ne bataya? Ye bhi main bata raha hu, ye genes ke liye hai. Okay. Now, QTL or mapping techniques versus reverse genetic tools. Reverse genetic tools mein aapke transgenics aayenge, you get your ACDCC, this thing, right? You get tilling approaches, anything else? There are four more. One more is there. Huh? RNA is an interference technology. Okay, what is the difference between reverse genetics tools and what is the between those of mapping tools? In mapping, you identify a new QTL or a gene, right? In reverse genetics tools, including transgenics, you utilize an already available gene information. You are not identifying any new gene, right? For example, in transgenics, already you know that in Bacillus amyloliquefaciens, you have a gene that hinders, right? The gut this thing and it kills the Lepidopteran pus. Therefore, you are actually using this gene to and using it in your transformation. So, all reverse genetics tool identify, use the already present genes or their analogs as you do in case of tilling, right? So, when you compare other approaches, you are looking, basically if you are looking, it is an expression analysis tools. Of course, again with an if you are using genomic tools, you have a forward genomic tools. That means you are going from the function, you are not going from, you are going from the gene to the function. In reverse genetics tools, you are coming from the function to the gene, right? You are coming from the function to the basically gene. Okay, that's right, RNAi is also there. So, tDNA insertion, that is transformation, ACDC system, the interference technology and the tilling technology. See, basically most of them are knockout methods. So, you require transformation, you require a large amount of transformation, you already have a problem or ban or environmental concerns or a huge lobby that is fighting against them or various other things, right? Then transposons way back in 1943 or when? First time, maize. So, it was discovered, but still we are unable to use because there are multiple site insert movements. This is multiple site insertion, this is multiple site movements. Stability is a question, how the change is a question, what other genes response is elicited is a question. RNA interference, as you know, is a multi-gene family. You are trying to interfere one, but you still are not sure what other things it would interfere and inhibit them. So, looking at these things, therefore, this is one of the biggest advantages that it does not work. Most of the things work as gene inactivation, or you need to be looking into places where still consumer acceptance is there, or there are limitations, hena, or transposon or ACDC system is very, very difficult. Now, there are some requirements also for tilling. It's not that, like I said, this is just, I do understand that within 1 hour, this is almost a, what you call a 7 or 8 course lecture if you would have taken advanced mutagenesis where they start trying to do this. So, basically what it happens, this is a repetition for you. Yeah, you have done that course. I was just looking. So, you need certain requirements. What you require? You need to understand that all reverse genetic tools require gene sequences. So, this also requires certain candidate gene sequences, right? Then the second thing is you require to know what is a standardized mutagen dose for tilling, right? Now, what I am trying to do is find out till how much part if I break the gene. Right? The response, the main response, let us say that particular gene gives for drought tolerance. Till how many base pairs I can go on cutting it, how many deletions I can make in it to just understand that its function is not impaired. Right? So, in case of mutation, you understand mutation mein kya hota hai? It is totally knocked out. I do not want knockout. Therefore, the name is lesion. I need to create lesions in the gene. So, you understand whenever you are working on entomological problems, pathological problems or mutation problems, you calculate what is called as LD50, lethal dose 50. Lethal dose 50 is that dose at which 50% of your test population is, it has died. So means that means because in mutation you want a knockout, you are sure if you are giving a mutagenic treatment which is at LD50 or more, you are sure to get a knockout. Therefore, you get a deletion and then you get a new expression of that gene. In tilling or in lesions, we are not looking at knockouts. We are looking at leachate expression of that gene so that I can understand till which part I can cut down both the appendages of legs of Thiviani to see she can't walk. Right? To which part I can cut down the DREB gene so that it does not lose its basic function. Right? This becomes very, very important. Anyway, so then another thing is you need to have a beautiful mutation source. There are many mutation sources which work. Certainly, I am not looking at mutations which totally knock out, that is all your radiation mutations. We are not looking at. So, we are looking at mutations which cause just base transitions or transversions. So, best candidate is EMS. Now, for example, Arabidopsis, for example, Caenorhabditis elegans, for example, EMS in case of chemicals are called as Cinderellas or the best sources for this thing. Why? You should know. For example, many chemical mutagens are there. Sodium azide is there, EMS is there, nitrous oxide is there. But why do we use EMS? EMS works normally at the pH of 7, almost 7, 6 to 7. So, it is very good. It is highly stable compared to others. It has a good LD50 value, right? So, you need to look out. Basically, treating is easier for the parts. So, it has been well worked out and has been seen how it functions. Its molecular basis of how does it function is well worked out. Therefore, generally EMS as a source for tilling is used. For mutation treatment, you have lot many, but for this, we use this. But most important is you require rapid phenotyping techniques and also a good bioinformatics pathway. Now, as I said, we need to overcome the yield barrier. So, you are looking at genes where you can knock out and look what their functions are. Then as you look in case of most of the pulses particularly or in case of most of the fruit crops and highly conserved species of vegetable crops. See, most of them belong to 5 or 6 major megagenome, Solanaceae or where almost all your vegetables have come out, right? So, we need to have, they have already a low polymorphism. You are working in which crop? And we didn't get polymorphism, large number of markers that her senior has tried, we could hardly get 20 or 25. So, this becomes a need. Or now you have large amount where the genome, the total genome has been sequenced and you can compare between genomes and you understand that the genes particularly for a process are highly conserved. You know, if you look at the course of evolution, the ones that can live or have not changed their form long have been the coleopterans. And this era they have ruled for if the evolution of man is just a point or a speck in the evolution of the earth, 42% of the earth's evolution period after which organisms have come has been ruled by coelozoids. And one which did not change is cockroach, right? These have ruled, right? Coelozoids. Then you had the Mesozoic era, right? Where the dinosaurs ruled. Then it had come the Equazoic era, where starting from horses, the four-legged creatures have used. Human era has just started and we are moving towards the humanoid era. You should understand, already humanoid era has started. Do you know we have a school in Bangalore, I forget its name, and 50% of the teaching is done by robots. I'll just send you, it is there, I'm not getting the name, I have it on my WhatsApp. It's done by robots with a human interference. So, you don't say we are far off. These robotoic, apne achha breakfast kaya, you're getting a good sleep. आप ही को I'm just asking you. It's okay, no problem. I used to also doze off. So, anyway. So you need to understand that while in this evolution, you would have seen, for example, in the reptiles, while the evolution was occurring, you will see that till the gastromere and till the blastomere, the embryoid development is same. A single cell, two cells, then a mass of cells, then a small hole forms by some of the cells getting absorbed, and then from here, within a particular group, within the amphibians, the thing is almost same, hana? With the reptiles, it is almost same till still further stages. Hana? So, what happens is somewhere between the Coelozoic era and the Mesozoic era, the genes started diverging. And if you remember, we have a box called as HOM, HOM. Hox, capital HOM by small HOX. This is Home Hox box. Now, these Home Hox box actually carries the genes for embryonic development. This is a very important box of genes. Why it's very important box of genes? If you look at the calf embryo, bachde ka embryo, human ka embryo, billi ka embryo, kutte ka embryo, kisi ke embryo mein pehle sir ki appendage nahi banti hai. पहले हाथों के छोटे छोटे है ना, इफ यू हैव सीन एट द प्लेसेंटास फिगर्स, पहले हाथों के छोटे छोटे बनते हैं, एक पूंछ की अपेंडेज रहती है ना, द अपेंडेजेस. देन हाथों का ऐसा नहीं है कि पहले ये वाली बन जाती है, पहले केवल ये अपेंडेज रहती है, फिर द सेकेंड अपेंडेज इज फॉर्म्ड, देन देर आर फिंगर लाइक स्ट्रक्चर्स, लेग लाइक स्ट्रक्चर्स फॉर्म्ड, देन द हेड शेप फॉर्म्स, है ना, देन द नोज इन द अपर ब्लब फॉर्म्स. Means the Home Hox box of genes, which has the embryonic development genes, has the genes in that series in which they are expressed, right? In almost all this group of animal kingdom, this gene box is highly conserved. And any variation in this box of genes either leads to fatality if there is some change in the sequences, or leads to evolution of a particular era. If there is a change in this gene frequency and you see the, for example, that gene helps in fitness. For example, totally aquatic animals to that which allowed them to breathe. So, this was basically a lung or the respiratory system in this thing. So, that did not do any lethality in case of fecundity, that is in case of reproductive, or in case of acquiring food. So, that was taken care of. That's why from your aquatic animals, the amphibians were able to evolve first, isn't it? So, such evolution occurred in pools where maybe due to cosmic radiation or something, and such rapid evolution we call it as Cambrian explosion, right? So, that means you understand that there are group of genes that are conserved across species. This is very, very important. So, if I have a group of genes conserved across species, here we are limiting ourselves to plants. In plants, we are limiting to fruits or horticultural crops. In horticultural crops, we have large families which are grown exclusively compared to the cereal crops within a particular group. So, if you have a gene that has been identified, you can look for its corollary in the line in the same group there you are working on. So, these such genes are called as candidates. Just to explain to you a candidate gene, means I would have just rushed wherever it is required, I am trying to explain. So, you need to have information on such candidate genes. Anyway, we will be looking at the tilling overview. So, basically you need to identify the EMS dose which does not cause killing of the 50% organisms. So, we put a dose which is less than the 50% or LD50. So, you need to first standardize the dose. Then the most important is, see, I am not creating a deletion stock. Deletion stock is always less in number, right? Maybe if there are n number of chromosomes, you will have n minus 1 deletion stocks. So if there are 32 chromosomes, because I need to look at, so I will have 31 deletion stocks. Less number, so easier to handle, right? But you will have, you need to, because you don't know, mutation is a random event, will be coming by how you will actually go through it, okay? So you need to have ways to pool this large, we were working on a population of about 10,000 or so, right? So you need to know how to pool the individuals. You need to identify how do you be amplifying your region of interest and how do you actually detect this region of interest, and then you identify the individual, okay? So, okay, I'll come back to this, okay. As I was saying, that EMS is a potential mutagen because it creates stable point mutations. It is GC to AT transitions almost 99% of the time. Now you can have genome wide saturated mutations, sodium azide, most of the chemical mutagens help in that. As I said, it is highly stable, it is about 7.6. You can get most useful phenotypic variants, and it is highly suitable for a thoroughput technology. Now we won't go to that. Now, before I come to this, I'll come back. Don't worry, I'll be coming back. Now, what happened basically was, I was working on identification and utilization of genes for drought tolerance in chickpea, right? It can be a corollary for your thing. Once I've joined and I came back from National Research Center Soybean to IRA and promotion, I was given the crop of chickpea, and I was actually working on chickpea, and we had a very good lab in ICRISAT, Varshney's lab, which was basically working on same drought tolerance. Now what a particular biotechnologist does is, he identifies the most resistant line, right? He identifies the most susceptible line. Now what he does a transcriptomic approach basically to identify which are genes responsible for this particular trait. He takes the most resistant line under normal condition and also under drought condition. He does a transcriptomics. Transcriptomics is nothing but those genes that are expressed under a given condition at a given point of time, right? So they make a cDNA, identify what are the genes that are expressing. These are also called as ESTs, express sequence tags. Simply put, you have a line which is under, which is most resistant under that stress condition and normal condition, and he subtracts among them and identifies a group of genes which are expressed or down-regulated, means not expressed in a particular stress. Now the same thing is there in a susceptible line also. Susceptible line also tries to protect itself, but not as much as the tolerant or the resistant line. So he does the same thing for the susceptible line. Now you have a set of genes which are expressed in the resistant line under stress conditions, and a susceptible line, a group of genes which are expressed also under what you call stress conditions in the susceptible line. He subtracts this genome. This is called as substitutional subtractive hybridization. So simply it states that you get a group of genes now which are only expressed in the resistant or the tolerant. Why I am using resistant? If it is for biotic stress, tolerant for abiotic stress. Expressed in the resistant or the tolerant line only under stress. And he does a beautiful publication, right? Saying that these are all the genes or the gene sequences which are expressed under stress conditions and responsible for this stress in the line A. Now Bhanushree, what she does, she gets these genes and starts trying to use them for her marker assisted breeding, or looking at which are the genes available, and many of them do not express. It is the same thing again coming to why I was taking a corollary of human example is, my hand is not responsible for walking. This is the stress condition, drought. Here it is walking. right? For example, I compared with a sponge or with an another organism, so it need not be, my hand is useful to me. So this is a housekeeping gene. So even under stress conditions, the tolerant genotype is doing some housekeeping functions. So you need to identify. So how you will do? Exactly, cutting down. You are understanding this? Exactly, you need to cut down and actually identify. No means, for example, in this, I was also a co-author in the initial publication which we have done in PLOS One. We have identified almost 2000 gene sequences which we reported as under ICC 4958. You would have seen a drought tolerant variety line. So they have been reported as the genes that are responsible for drought tolerance. Now, since I was a breeder, I started using them in my breeding program, and absolutely none of them were expressing. So I need to identify now genes which are only show, which are available, which are working. Of course, these are the genes or their sequences which are known, but they are also showing drought tolerant, right? If that particular sequence is amplified, but that particular line does not show drought tolerance, that means it is a housekeeping gene, right? It is a marker for that variety or for that line, but it is basically a housekeeping gene. That gene is not there, but there is drought tolerance. It can happen the corollary also. The line is showing drought tolerance, but this amplification is not there for that gene. Even in that case, that becomes a housekeeping gene. No way useful in your tilling population. So you need to get a line which is showing drought tolerance, which is actually having that gene, then you need to work out a linkage analysis, right? But as I said, we have a very large population, right? So initially what we were doing is we were standardizing, but now let me come back before. This is not required. We have a very large population. As I was saying, 5,000 or 10,000, there is a way how to calculate the size of the mutation population. For example, in case of, I'm sorry, I'm just, it is too hot. I thought there will be fan. Renadu, no problem. See, what I was saying is, in case of a mutagenic population that you are creating, the population size is very, very large. In our mutagenic treatment, we created a population size of 10,000. Now, if I run 10,000 PCRs, it's literally very, very difficult, isn't it? Very difficult to handle itself. Aki Marker, he has reported about 700 genes which we got through SSH, and the 700 genes into 10,000, 70,000 PCR. So it becomes just impossible, maybe 5 years, 6 years. So you require an automation and pooling technology. So what you can do, all of you have seen a PCR mat, isn't it? 12 into 8, 96 wells are there, right? So you need to first, when you have created a mutagenic population, what you basically can do is, for example, in this you can put 8 individuals' DNA after normalizing, bringing them to the same concentration, right? You can put 8 individuals' DNA. So one plate will have how many individuals? 768 individuals. So if 4 plates were sufficient to have 3072, this is single X. If you are putting only just 8 individuals, it is single X pooling. If you do 4 times, you can almost cover these individual 3072 into 1. That is 8464. If I put in 1, I can cover 3072 individuals into 1 well lot, right? So this is called as DNA pooling. Whether you are doing single X, double X, 8 double X means 16 individuals. If you are putting 3X pooling, that means 83 is 24 individuals into 1 well. Now what you do? You have your marker. If you are using a fluorescent marker, if you are using even a general marker, when you run a particular gel, so it will not amplify in all. Wherever that mutation or that particular gene is there, only in that it will amplify. Now this, it will amplify only in that. Now this has, you know that this has 8 individuals or 16 individuals or 24 individuals. Now you need to run along with this particular marker only for those 16 individuals, right? Only for those 24 individuals or only for those 8 individuals. When basically, okay, this is what is double X pooling or triple X pooling. Let me come to that. It is not here. I will remove. Okay. Whenever first you run it, what happens is if you look down, for example, this particular image, in case of 700, you get a single band, that is the wild phenotype, and where it is broken, you get two bands in the same lane, indicating there is a lesion. Right? There is a particular lesion. Now what you do, these 8 individuals which you have got, till now you have not looked at phenotype. You are understanding this? I have done an M0 my treatment there. I have grown each line into a huge population. So if my tilling LD 50 nahi hai, lethal dose, this is 30% where I have standardized using a kill curve, I will be showing. Then what I say, I give 30% more amount of seed. 1 kg seed may, if I give a treatment, I do understand that I will get only 700. Let's say I have given 1000 individuals, 30 will die and 700 is only required. So if I have to make a population of 5000, so I almost give 5 times this many seeds I treat. It varies, you know, you need to look out. Generally we keep 25 to 30% as the lethal dose for tilling. For mutation we keep LD 50. You have to make a kill curve. I'll be coming. Please don't put it down. You need to make a kill curve. So what I do now, only those 8 individuals I take out, and then where this particular gene is there, only that I actually phenotype. See, because this is a huge amount of pooling, you won't get just 1 or 2. You may get 20 or 30. But I need to now look at only these 20 or 30 or let's say even 100 in 10,000. 100 individuals I need to look at very carefully. Whereas, for example, genotyping of 10,000 individuals, what is genotyping of 10,000, phenotyping of 10,000 individuals, and now you are concentrating on 8, 10 or 100 individuals. You come down. See, your ability to discern this character is very, very high. This is the advantage of tilling, right? So that is what we have, certain limitations, either when you are using the Leica or gel, or this is basically for my class notes, but this is not required for you people. So what I mean to stress upon is that it's a simple procedure. It has high sensitivity and high efficiency, provided you have automation. This is very much essential. Manually you are prone to what you call as pipetting errors or running errors, isn't it? So you need to have. Today you have robotic systems where it automatically, if some of you had visited ICRISAT, you would have seen in building 300, where in the genomics lab, where it actually automatically you can lift, you can pull this, and there is precision now. It is easier, it's not. And don't think it's costly. It's very cheap. We'll be coming to the next steps. Creating mutation is not at all a big dose. All you require is dedicated staff who can do good phenotyping, and you require equipment or you require outsourcing facilities where you basically can do this. So it has high sensitivity and high efficiency. Okay. So another thing is that it provides the precise position. This tilling population, now you have a wild source. Still none of you has asked this question. Aap, main socha, aap log puchenge, sir, aapne bola mutation is a random event. Right? पर आप बोल रहे हो इसमें प्रिसाइज कर सकते हैं कैसे. प्रोवाइडेड अगेन आई टोल्ड यू, यू शुड नो व्हाट इज द ऑब्जेक्टिव. यू नो फॉर विच टारगेट ट्रेट एंड वेयर द ट्रेट एक्सप्रेसेस यू आर लुकिंग फॉर. यू कैन डू टिलिंग फॉर अ जनरल व्हाट यू कॉल कॉन्स्टिट्यूट ट्रेट विच इफ यू आर टारगेटिंग. यू शुड अंडरस्टैंड दिस. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, व्हेन आई वाज स्पीकिंग ऑफ ड्राउट, if you look back to the papers or where we have released varieties, so you will look that we are targeting the root trait. Mutation is a random event, but the tissue transcriptomics which I was looking for is root. You should understand this, right? So all the genes or the earlier SSH publication was basically in the root tissue. So I know that mutation occurs everywhere. I was targeting the root trait. So therefore, I'll be looking at phenotyping of this root only, right? So from that, you mind, from 750 putative candidate genes, the marker-assisted breeding program, we are the first to release world's marker-assisted bred drought-tolerant variety in chickpeas centrally. Just last year we had released. And you know, we could come how many genes? Just four candidate genes. Just four candidate genes. For root volume 2 and for root length 2. Whenever we are speaking of gene, it should give more than 30%. So this is on a QTL hotspot and we introgress this. After us, Ethiopia was second to release this line, right? So that means where, no means I would have been working at 750, means 4 out of 750 means the rest all were housekeeping genes, okay? So you need to know what we had to do. So we had to take the wild type and these 8 in which it was showing variation but showing what? Drought tolerance. Now, आप ये बोल सकते हो सर ये तो ऑलरेडी ड्राउट टॉलरेंस का जीन आपने आइडेंटिफाई कर लिया सीधा उसको यूज करो द लॉन्गर द जीन द डिफिकल्ट इट इज टू इंट्रोग्रेस वाई लेट से जस्ट न्यूअर नेम आई टेक योर नेम ओके पांचाल सो पांचाल जी ने क्या किया कि एक बड़ी जीन को ली और उसको SSR मार्कर्स आई विल बी कमिंग टू सेंटर आई एम सॉरी the SSR markers he has used. Now, what is the general length of SSR marker? 24, 27, 20. Forward एक use करते हो, reverse एक use करते हो. बगल में रखो, let's say exactly there. बहुत बार तो forward and reverse overlapping होते हैं. 20, 20, 40, right? But the smallest gene in plant kingdom, except the smallest gene is 0.5 kb, is human insulin gene. Isko chhodke baki sab genes bahut bade hain. Dusra, wherever the sequence is there, it will be. It need not be that it is only what you say targeting the drought tolerant gene. It may wherever that sequence is there, it will go and attach. This is second lesson for you. You should always refer to the original paper at how many base pairs the original gene got amplified. You should get at least that. That was why I was explaining in LICOR. Only at that band position, you have two bands in that lane, then only it corresponds to that gene. Rest all will be what you call as outliers. Okay. So this is one more problem. So therefore, if you are able to narrow down the gene sequence to that region where its function is not lost, the narrower it is, jitne kam base pairs hai, the easier it is to introgress. You are understanding? It is easier to be introgressing that gene sequence than whole length gene. For to mine the whole length gene, you can mine it, it becomes only again an academic approach. You need to introgress it, you need to use it. If you don't use it, it becomes a basic study. And we are into the applied part. So it is important that you find the allelomorphs and you get such allelomorph which is the lowest in size but gives the function. So whatever it is, so what happens is you can get different allelic mutations of the gene interest and the best fit gene which you get, you can use it for your whatever, for marker assisted this thing. Then a small mutant population gives you a large amount of saturation. Tilling is a approach, but at the same time you look what are the parallel products that are coming. And you see, in case of horticultural crops, any variation which is novel, maybe a smaller fruit size for pickling tomato or pickling cucumbers or gherkins, what you call, right? It may be useful. A novel flower color may be useful, right? So you should understand this. All of you are horticultural students. You should be proud that our horticulture was first in everything. For example, QTL analysis dunya mein pehli bar successfully kahin hua to, it was in tomato. It was not in rice, it was not in wheat. Tilling anywhere, first it is in tomato again. From Lycopersicum, Pimpinellifolium, you got the genes for fruit size, fruit number, for TSS content, for rind thickness. So you should understand this, that we have a good amount of variation also that can be raised through tilling, and this becomes a genomic source. Why? because you have a small pool now which has been worked out. Maybe, for example, let's say, like I was saying, like we have done in chickpea for drought tolerance, I know the root, but the same tilling population can be used for the pod size if there is a variation in the large pod size. And if I get a variation, if I have genes that have been identified for pod size and or seed size, then I can look into it, isn't it? And then identify gene which is giving larger seed size, which is of more useful in case of carboxylates. So you have a large amount of applications, for example, for gene discovery, for polymorphism assessment, or basically for what you call as crop breeding. Now, many a time creating a tilling population becomes very, very difficult, right? Where seed set is a problem, or where the gestation period, the time to produce the reproductive part, set seed and grow them becomes very, very difficult. So it's important that we have different approaches. For example, you can also use the genetic sources that are already available and till them, use mutagenic treatment in them and use for eco-tilling. If you use them directly for your mapping, it becomes genome-wide association studies, GWAS. So that is the only difference that you are using. But what happens is, in such a cases, what we call as background noise may be different. For example, when we are looking at the genomic sources between Bhanushri, Tevyani and me, maybe we both will be close basically because we are from south, but we may be far away with respect to the genomic pool, may be far away. Let's add some more people. Let's say we are using between the African population, Asian population, European, New Zealand, Aborigines, then the variation will be closer between the Indian and the African population because Indian subcontinent came down from the African subcontinent. So you need to understand that there will be a greater amount of background noise. Nevertheless, this becomes one more important rule. The process remains the same, that you have a different group of individuals, you pool the individuals after giving a mutation treatment. Then what you start looking is looking at your gene of interest in this large pool. We are not speaking of 200 or 300 pools. If it is a 10,000 or 5,000 for what you call as tilling, the eco-tilling pools become as high as 20,000 or so. So therefore, you should know. So that means I needn't follow eco-tilling in my crops like annual vegetable crops. But in case of fruit crops where the gestation period is more or so, we can basically follow. Anyway, this we have covered. See, at every stage it gives. For example, you have a mutagenesis, you have chimeras. If they are easily propagated vegetatively, you get a new stock, right? No, you have a separate line, you get into a mutation stock. A large number of tilling in different crop plants has been done, including most of this is for example, in case of tomato, in potato, in peanut. This is our standardization of tilling procedure. When you are doing standardization of tilling procedure, you take the same mutagen and you start treating your base population at different sources. This is an annual crop, but in case of vegetative or in case of your fruit crops, you decide the dose on the amount of chimeric populations that come out in your tissue culture. You need to have an in vitro this thing and look how much is the chimeric proportion. A large chimeric proportion indicates that the dosage is very high. So what we start doing is we start making a kill curve. Now why I call it as a kill curve is the moment I cross 0.2 and I come to 0.3% EMS, everything's drastically decreased, whether it was shoot length, whether it was root length, or the number of abnormal seedlings. So therefore I decided that 0.2% is the what you call as the EMS dose for tilling. Then I'll run a pilot experiment. In case of annual crops, you can do it in phytotron and look how it affects your target trait, whether it is root or shoot. So we started looking at those things, whether it's plant height, plant biomass, and how much it is. And so therefore, we have decided 0.2%. We started looking at a tilling population. The presence of loop mutations, which you can immediately see, or chimeras in the tissue cultural experiments indicate the amount of tilling that has occurred. So you need to identify them. Hana? You need to then look at, we got a large number of this thing and actually looked at that 0.2% is giving a viable source for tilling experiment. So we started working into it. So what we have done is, if you look down, a large number of unigenes are, as I was saying, we could get about 700, and this was what actually has gone into publication. But then we started looking, key out of these 700 or 800, we could get only 4 candidate genes, as I was explaining before. So this has been used as a large point to create in case of tomato. In case of tomato, not only that, there they got, of course, 0.18 as the tilling population, this thing. But at the same time, a large amount of variations were coming. And the most important was, of course, these are all floral or leaf variations, but the variation that they got for the fruit type, the fruit thickness or the TSS content was very, very important. And what they did, they started releasing this improved red setter. This is used for what you call a scanning industry. So you got a variation without using any transgenic approach. Okay? So you got a variant which was used using transgenic approach. It's okay, you got a variant, that's not important. But you already know what gene expresses this variant. Because you know that this particular gene expresses this variant at this so many allelic pairs, and now you have a strong marker that has been developed for this gene. Now, since you know that there is a strong marker developed for this gene, you can directly use in its MABC approach, right? Marker assisted back cross. I'm saying always a gene, I'm not using the, because I'm looking at a variation that is giving more than 24 or 25%. Okay, so this is very, very important. It has been done in case of Brassica rapa. I should actually wind up. Even in case of Cucumis, because I'm just running short of time. In case of snaps, that's what I'm saying. There are large amount of tilling centers. For example, if you look down, we are the world's leading in case of chickpea. UC Davis, many people from here, for example, T.R. Sharma, who is now joint director research at Palampur, and me, we had gone to this UC Davis library, laboratory under Dolos Cook to get trained in the tilling group. So this is a useful tool. Again, I say it's a useful tool to not identify novel genes, but to identify the allelic variants of the already existing genes, to look at what is the function of these genes which is known, but what will be their phenotypic effect, what is the allelomorph which you can actually use in breeding program. Okay, we have a large amount of students, but I close it here, and I would like to have questions from you. This marker assisted or any topic which you are interested in. Louder. Forward genetics, अब reverse genetics में कहाँ से आ रहे हो आप? नहीं, back से नहीं आ रहे. You are not coming from back.